worthy of every song you could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we'll live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we'll live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we'll live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around you. Shalom everybody, welcome to SIMB TV. Once again, it is me, Reverend Edmund Smith. I'm a pastor and I'm also an ex-transgender. And this is my YouTube channel, sharing my heart to the world, the news, the life, the challenges, the beauty of being an ex-transgender. Today I would like to respond to some questions asked based on a video that I made recently where I shared about my current sexual orientation, which is a demisexual orientation. I will put a link of that video in my video description of this video. So let me go quickly to that question, those questions asked by one of my viewers. Let me just go there. Hey Ed, great stuff. Watch your video on you focusing on demisexuality. And he said, my understanding on demisexuality would be someone who's attracted by emotional attachment, which is true, over physical attachment, which is quite contradictory to heterosexuality or homosexuality or even bisexuality, which is correct. A demisexual orientation, it's kind of different from all of the other regular sexual orientations. Generally, sexual orientations are very much a physical attraction, a physical sexual orientation where people are drawn to another based on what they see. So that is like a common thing in terms of sexual orientation. So this, let's look at this question. My questions on that. Number one, some people believe that sexual orientations are natural. as in they are part of your genes, and some would believe that they are choices that you make. How would you view or argue that any type of sexual orientation, including demisexuality, are choices rather than part of our genes? Of course, there's this debate that has been going on for generations under generations. There are basically two points of view. There are one camp that says that sexual orientation is nurture, means it's something that you develop based on your experiences, based on what you've been through, your culture, and a lot of things that you experience as a child. And when puberty hits you come to a place of developing that sexual orientation. And on the other hand, there are those who believe it's nature. It means you are born with it. It's connected to your genes and many other biological aspects, okay? And there's still no evidence on both sides of the story, okay? Basically, both sides of this, of both views are presenting sharings based on people's experiences, their theories, and all kinds of things. For me personally, I believe that sexual orientation is nurture. It's something that when a human being is born, there is no such thing as sexual orientation. I don't believe any human being is born and they like kind of know, I want to be sexually involved with this person or that kind of people, or you know, no child, no regular child has this desire for sexual intimacy with anyone. It's something that it grows. Of course, attraction, yes. Attraction, I believe, even as young children, we are attracted to people. But attraction does not equate sexual orientation. That is something else altogether. So my point of view, I believe that sexual orientation, it's nurture. It's very much nurture. It's something that you develop. And by the time you hit puberty, you come to a place, because puberty, and when you enter into the time of adolescence, it's where you are getting prepared for marriage, for most people at least. And that's where the orientation comes around, the sexual orientation comes around. I believe that our sexual orientation and sexual attraction are two different things. They're very much related. Okay, sexual attraction is basically the you deciding what you are going to allow yourself to be attracted to. That's sexual attraction. You know, I made some videos of the difference between admiration and attraction. Sexual orientation, on the other hand, which is something that's inside of you based on what you've been through in life, the good and the bad, that's related to your sexuality, that brings you to the place of declaring your sexuality or acknowledging your sexuality. Your sexual orientation is basically something you do not choose. You come to that place of experiencing the natural. You come to the place of where it becomes natural, or whom you are drawn to in the area of sexual. That's your orientation. But together with your orientation, mixed with your morals, mixed with your conscience, that's where your sexual attraction comes about. So let me just summarize that. What is sexual orientation? Sexual orientation is something that's inside of you. It's not a choice that you make. Many things happen to you in the past, and you develop the sexual orientation. So sexual orientation, of course, is plays a very big part in our sexual attraction. So sexual orientation, put together with our conscience, put together with our morals, and that's where our sexual attraction comes about. So sexual attraction is a choice. Sexual orientation is not. And with sexual orientation comes sexual attraction, then comes sexual lifestyle. Lifestyle is how you live your life in the area of your sexuality. All right? So going back to his first question, so he says, is it a choice rather than or not a choice? So I would this is my belief, and people can always have their own belief, especially when there's no pure evidence, you know. So there's still no pure evidence whether sexual orientation is it's genetic, it's whether it's nature or nurture. So I hold on. One of the major reasons why I hold on to this belief system that sexual orientation is nurture, it's something that you build as you grow, is because I've experienced a change of sexual orientation. I went from having, I believe as a child, I had an asexual orientation. I believe that every regular child will have an asexual orientation. An asexual orientation simply means you are not sexually attracted to anyone. Yes, you are attracted to people, but it's all purely platonic. Platonic means non-sexual. So I personally went from an asexual orientation to a homosexual orientation, and then to a bisexual orientation, and now to a demisexual orientation. And I'm comfortable and pleased with the current sexual orientation that I have. Okay, let's go to the second question. He has about 5 questions here. Number 2, he says, is there a possibility that someone who calls themselves a demisexual would end up being gay or bisexual, asexual, rather than becoming heterosexual? I would say yes, because at the end of the day, you know, our sexual lifestyle, so he is not using the term sexual orientation. I guess he doesn't really know the difference between orientation, sexual attraction and sexual lifestyle. So people, when people talk about sexuality, especially in terms of sexual orientation, they tend to put all these three into one box, but they actually can be divided. As I'm trying to explain in this video, there's a difference, though it's connected, but it's different. Sexual orientation, sexual attraction, and sexual lifestyle, they're three different things, but nevertheless very close knitted. So based on his second question, he says, is it possible for someone with a demisexual orientation end up with a being gay or bisexual? Or yes, of course, you know, because at the end of the day, the lifestyle you choose is a choice. Your attraction is a choice. Besides, except for your orientation. Your orientation is not a choice. Your current orientation is not a choice. But your attraction and your lifestyle is definitely a choice. And also, what kind of lifestyle you choose will slowly but surely affect your orientation. It will affect. So what you expose to, whom you mix with, what you allow to come into your life will definitely affect your attraction, your lifestyle, and eventually will also affect your orientation. So I believe I experienced the change of my sexual orientation is because of the kind of attraction I allow myself to have, the kind of lifestyle I allow myself to live. So basically, it's all related. You can divide them three individually, but what type of attraction you allow yourself to have, and what kind of lifestyle you allow yourself to live, I'm talking about sexual now, it will affect your orientation eventually. Okay, number 2, question 3. Would you encourage a heterosexual or homosexual, asexual to become demisexual? Would I encourage? I don't think I tried to develop a demisexual orientation. I would say a sexual orientation is something that happens supernaturally, naturally. You know, I believe that, of course, there's divine intervention where God intervened. And I believe, as I said, because of what I expose myself, the kind of attraction I allow myself to have, the kind of life I live has caused me to have, to develop, to go from a homosexual orientation to a bisexual orientation and now to a demisexual orientation. It's not a choice I make. Sexual orientation change happens naturally. It's not something, oh, I want to have a heterosexual orientation. Oh, I want to have a demisexual. It's not like that. It does not work that way. So in my ministry, in fact, you know, for those who do not know, I started and founded and served in a ministry called Real Love Ministry. And in short, we are known as RLM. And this video channel that I'm running, it's kind of related to my ministry as well. You know, we don't even try to work on people's sexuality. Our primary goal is basically to link people to Jesus Christ. We are a Christian ministry to help people see God through Jesus Christ, to help people have a relationship with God, to help people realize that God loves them so much. It's not so much about trying to restore people's sexuality. We're trying to restore people's relationship with God. And of course, when that takes place in someone's life, the restoration between the person and God takes place, many beautiful things happen. This is how it happened to me. I went from a wild, crazy transgender woman to a wild, crazy gay, and today I am not wild anymore. I'm married to a woman. I have two wonderful children. I hate a ministry. I'm helping thousands and thousands of people, encouraging them to walk in the path I believe that is better, which is a godly path, a biblical path. Question number four. What is a biblical definition towards demisexuality, and how would you create a line for a demisexual to not become a homosexual or bisexual? Well, if you're already a demisexual, I mean, you have come to a super beautiful place, because you are no longer attracted to people physically. A person with a demisexual orientation, as you will see in my other video, and I'll leave the link below, as I said earlier, is for us, people like us, we have come to a place of not being sexually attracted to people based on their physicality, you know, and that's not going to happen. So for me, the reason I've come to a place of being sexually attracted to my wife, it was because of the emotional connection with her. I'm not sure I'm answering his question, this guy's question, according to what he wants to hear, because I don't think he does not make it clear whether he's talking about sexual orientation or sexual attraction and sexual lifestyle. And if you're watching this, the one who asked this question, I would say do attend my victory talks or my victory V-meets, my victory meetings. I run two programs that's called the victory talks and the victory meeting. Do attend it, you know, so to understand, because clearly by your questions, it shows that you have very minimal understanding on sexuality. Okay, so basically, to boil down from these questions, I would say, I would like to just go back to what I said earlier to summarize what I'm saying today, which is sexual orientation, sexual attraction, sexual lifestyle, they are related, but they're not the same thing. Sexual orientation is the part of you, and most people develop a sexual orientation when you hit puberty. Okay, then sexual attraction is something that you make a choice. You come to a place of choosing. Sexual orientation is not a choice. But of course, the biggest part of your sexual attraction is your sexual orientation. Sexual attraction, sexual orientation mixed with your conscience, mixed with your morals, then that's where you have your sexual attraction. Sexual attraction, basically what you allow yourself to be attracted to, how you allow yourself to be attracted to. And then this part of you is your sexual lifestyle. Your sexual lifestyle is basically the kind of sexual lifestyle you are living. Yeah, so I hope I'm not confusing you. That's not my goal. And if you're wondering why is this finger of mine blacked, this is an indication that I voted for Malaysia, my country that I live in. Whenever we do our voting 4 years once, every 4 years one time, then we will have to dip our finger in the ink to say that I have voted. So don't think that I have a skin disease whatsoever, right? I'd like to just close this video with a Bible verse, as usual. And I hope that you'll be blessed with this Bible verse, which I used for my sermon yesterday, and it's taken from 2 Timothy 3:16-17, and God's word says this: all scriptures, not some, not the ones that you liked, but all scriptures is God breath, and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God, which is all of us, servant of God, every Christian is a servant of God. Every Christian are supposed to serve God. And that's why we got saved. We were not saved to just sit down and do whatever we like. We got saved and we were left behind on this planet so that we can serve the Father. Alright? I read that again. So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Yes, when we serve God, we are doing good work. We are producing fruits. We are touching souls. We are bringing souls closer to the Lord Jesus Christ. I read that again. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. All scriptures is God breath and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. You know, basically at the end of the day, I believe God had worked so hard to give us these precious 66 books in the Bible. And this is our blueprint. You know, some people have not come to that place. I was there before. It wasn't forever that I was in this place where I believe that the Bible is God's word, and my whole life is leaned towards God's word. The The Bible to me is the blueprint, my backbone. You know, so whenever someone says, oh, God says this, I will always go back to God's word, to the Bible to check. If it's not in the Bible, to me, it's not of God. You know, God worked so hard to give us the Bible, and that's why, you know, we are blessed. I am blessed. I thank God. I don't have to turn to anyone, you know, but the Bible. You know, some people say, oh, we turn to God, not the Bible. God worked so hard. Jesus said, Jesus is the Word became flesh. Jesus is the Bible. When you are reading the Bible, you are reading Jesus. Jesus is the Word becoming flesh. That means the Bible became transforming to flesh, that's Jesus. So you want to hear God's voice, turn to the Bible. And all of it, you know, and that's why I always say this as well. We need God's Word and God's Spirit, not just God's Word. If you just lean on God's Word, then it becomes a religion. Christianity is not a religion. Christianity is a relationship with God. It's more than a religion, a relationship with the Creator, with the Father. So we need the Word of God and the Spirit of God. So there's so much in the Word of God, and are we supposed to follow everything that's in the Bible? Of course not. And how do we know what to follow and what not to follow? That's where the Spirit of God comes in. The Spirit of God will lead us. But if you feel you need to follow something and it's not in the Bible, then it's definitely not of God. And if you are sensing in your spirit that God is telling you to do something or not do something, that has to be in the Word of God. The Word of God is always there to back you up, to confirm that it is God. So we don't have to follow everything that the Bible says, but we need to follow what the Spirit of God says. And whatever the Spirit of God says is definitely in the Bible somewhere out there. And that's why it's good to study the Word of God daily. I like to just close this video with the song I started off, and this was basically the theme song of our retreat, RLM retreat. We try to have an annual retreat for anyone who wants to experience Jesus. So we had this song as our retreat theme song, 2018. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. God bless you. Shalom, and have a great day. Have a great life. Thank you for watching this video. Bye-bye.